Hey everybody, this video is an introduction to matrices. I plan to demonstrate some basic matrix operations and describe their properties. Matrix is a rectangular array of data, similar to a spreadsheet, except we're going to assume that all of our data is numeric. We usually use uppercase letters to name or represent a matrix. Matrices are classified by their order, which is the number of rows and columns it contains. An M by N matrix refers to a matrix with M rows and N columns. Here's a few examples. Matrix A is a 1x4 matrix because it has one row and four columns. Similarly, matrix B is 1x1, matrix C is 4x2, and matrix D is 3x3. There are some special cases that warrant their own name. If a matrix only has a single row, then it's called a row matrix. If it has a single column, it's called a column matrix. And if the number of rows is equal to the number of columns, it's called a square matrix. Typically, we use lowercase letters of the alphabet to refer to elements of a matrix. We designate which particular element by using a subscript like ij, where the first number specifies the row and the second specifies the column containing the element. So for example, in the matrix shown here, the element A sub 1, 2 refers to the element in row 1 and column 2, which in this case is negative 2. Similarly, the element A sub 3, 1 is the value in row 3 and column 1, which is 1. This notation allows us to easily identify particular elements or describe behavior of elements when performing a matrix operation. For instance, here we define the main diagonal of a matrix as being all the elements of the form A sub II, that is, elements where the row is the same as the column. Likewise, we define two matrices A and B as being equal if and only if A and B have the same order, and A sub IJ equals B sub IJ for every I and J. Here's a simple example using this definition. We can rewrite a system of equations as two equal column matrices. We'll extend this idea further shortly. Our first two matrix operations are addition and subtraction. First, note that in order to add or subtract matrices, they must have the same order, that is, the same number of rows and columns, and the result will be a matrix of the same order. If they have the same order, then we add matrices by adding corresponding elements. So A sub IJ just gets added to B sub IJ. Likewise, to subtract two matrices, we just subtract corresponding elements. If matrix B is subtracted from matrix A, then the elements of B are all subtracted from the corresponding elements of A. Here you can see an example of defining addition and subtraction for two general 2x3 matrices. Let's consider a specific example. Here we want to add a pair of 2x2 matrices. The result of adding these 2x2 matrices will be a new 2x2 matrix. The element in row 1 and column 1 of our resulting matrix will be the sum of the elements from row 1 and column 1 of the two matrices we're adding. In this case, that means negative 4 and 6, which yields 2 for the new element. For row 1 and column 2, we add the elements in row 1 and column 2 together and get 3 plus minus 3, which equals 0. Continuing, we get 7 plus 2 equals 9 for row 2, column 1, and negative 6 plus 4 equals negative 10 for row 2 and column 2. Here's an example where we're subtracting two matrices with order 3x2. Hence, our result will also be a 3x2 matrix. To find what goes in row 1, column 1, we just subtract the two elements in row 1 and column 1. Thus, 5 minus a negative 4 gives us a positive 9. Doing the same for every other row and column, we get the matrix shown here. 9, negative 9, 5 for the first column, and negative 4, 7, negative 2 for the second. We'll sometimes refer to the zero matrix. This is just a matrix where all the elements equal zero. Notice the zero matrix acts like an identity for matrix addition, just like the number zero is an identity for adding real numbers. Our next operation is multiplying a matrix by a constant, which is referred to as a scalar. If we think of multiplication of positive integers as repeated addition, then we can interpret 3a as meaning a plus a plus a. We can evaluate this using our previous definition, and it's easy to see that we're just adding every element three times, which means we have three times every entry. So we can generalize this idea to give us a definition for multiplying by any scalar. If a is a matrix and c is a scalar, then we can define c times a as multiplying c times every element of a. That is, c times a sub ij. Notice in our general definition, c can be any real number. Multiplying by a scalar does not change the order. Here, for instance, we're given a matrix B and asked to find negative 6 times B. By our definition, this means we multiply negative 6 times every element of B. So negative 6 times negative 1 gives us a positive 6 for the new element in row 1, column 1. Similarly, negative 6, negative 2 equals 12 for row 1, column 2, and so forth. For this next example, we are given two 2 by 2 matrices, A and B, and asked to calculate 3A plus 2B. We start by performing the scalar multiplication on each matrix. Multiply each element of A by 3 and each element of B by 2. Thus, 3A is negative 12, 3, 9, 0, and 2B is negative 2, negative 4, 16, 10. Now we're adding two 2 by 2 matrices, so we just add the ijth element from 3a to the corresponding ijth element of 2b. Our result is the 2 by 2 matrix, negative 14, negative 1, 25, 10. Just like with regular variables, we take a matrix with a minus in front of it to mean negative 1 times the matrix, which of course means to multiply the scalar negative 1 times every element of the matrix. Given this interpretation, we again have patterns very similar to real numbers. For any matrix A, we see that A plus minus A is equals the zero matrix. And matrix subtraction, A minus B, is the same as A plus negative B. In fact, addition and scalar multiplication have a number of properties very similar to real numbers. For instance, A plus B equals B plus A, so matrix addition is commutative. Matrix addition is associative, so A plus B plus C does not depend on which pair is added first. The zero matrix acts like an identity element, and every element A has an additive inverse minus A, since A plus minus A equals the zero matrix. For scalars, the number 1 is a multiplicative identity. Scalars distribute across matrix addition, and matrices distribute across scalar addition. Using these properties, we can solve simple linear matrix equations like the one shown here. Given matrices A and B, find a matrix X such that 3X plus A equals B. We can solve this just like an ordinary linear equation. We want to get the matrix X by itself, so first add negative A to both sides. Reassociate, A plus minus A gives us the zero matrix. 3X plus 0 equals 3X, so we now have 3X equals B minus A. Now multiply both sides by 1/3 to get rid of the 3, and finally we have X equals 1/3 times B minus A. Plugging in matrices A and B, we get that X equals the matrix negative 1, negative 2, 0, negative 5. Our final operation for this video is matrix multiplication. Matrix multiplication is significantly less intuitive than our first two operations. We'll start by defining the dot product of a 1 by m row matrix A with an m by 1 column matrix B. This requires multiplying the ith element of A times the ith element of B and adding up the m different products. Note that the result of the dot product is going to be a single scalar. Consider this example. A is the row matrix negative 1, 0, square root of 3, and B is the column matrix 5, negative 7, square root of 27. The value of A dot B is the product of the first elements, negative 2, 5, plus the product of the second element, 0, negative 7, plus the product of the third element, square root of 3 times square root of 27. This gives us negative 10 plus 0 plus 9, which equals negative 1. Another example would be to break apart a polynomial with a single variable into a row matrix of the coefficients dotted with the column matrix for powers of x. Now we can use the dot product to help us define the actual product of two general matrices. If A is an m by n matrix and B is an n by r matrix, then the product of A and B is an m by r matrix, where the ijth element is the dot product of row I of A with column j of B. The way to picture this is shown below. We have an m by n times an n by r. In order to be compatible, the two inner values must be the same. The result will be the two outer values. Here's an example where A is a 2 by 3 and B is a 3 by 2. If we multiply A times B, we see the inner numbers are both 3, so the matrices are compatible. And our result will be a 2 by 2, since that is the outer values of their order. The element in row 1 and column 1 of our product will be the dot product of row 1 from A and column 1 of B. In this case, that's 1 times 3 plus 0 times negative 1 plus negative 5 times 0, which is 3 plus 0 plus 0, which is 3. For the element in the first row, second column, we take the dot product of row 1 of A with the column 2 of B. This gives us 1 times 1 plus 0 times 4 plus negative 5 times 2, which equals 11. Likewise, the elements in row 2, column 1 is the dot product of row 2 with column 1, and the element in row 2, column 2 is the dot product of row 2 and column 2. So the result of our matrix product is the 2 by 2 matrix 3, 11, 9, negative 8. Notice what happens if we swap the matrices and multiply B times A. Now we have a 3 by 2 times a 2 by 3. Since the 2's match, they're still compatible, but this time our result is a 3 by 3. Now we play the same game as before. The elements in row 1, column 1 is the dot product of row 1 of B, this time since it occurs first, and column 1 of A, since which gives us 3 times 1 plus 1 times 2, which equals 5. We finish out the top row of our product by taking the dot product of row 1 with column 2, and then row 1 with column 3. Then we take the dot product of row 2 of B with each column of A, and finally row 3 of B with each column of A. So our result is the matrix 5, negative 3, negative 16, 7, negative 12, 1, negative 4, 6, and 2. Clearly, matrix multiplication is not commutative. You can see here, even if you have two square matrices, typically that AB does not equal BA. The situation is even worse for general matrices, such as this case where A is a 2 by 2 and B is a 2 by 4. We can calculate A times B using our dot product definition, but B times A is not even defined. We can't multiply a 2 by 4 times a 2 by 2 because the inner numbers do not match. Even though we do not have the commutative property, we do still have most of our other ones. Matrix multiplication is associative, so the order we perform the products does not matter. We can distribute matrix products across matrix sums. Notice that since matrix multiplication does not commute, the side matters for the distributive property. If we distribute from the left, then the matrix we distribute must appear on the left side. If we distribute from the right, then the distributed matrix must also be on the right. In spite of this rather strange definition, matrix multiplication is actually very useful. Here's two simple examples. First, consider the system of equations we represented earlier as two equal matrices. Using our new definition, we can break the left-hand side apart as one matrix containing all the linear coefficients times another matrix containing just the variables. Now we have a matrix equation, A times X equals B, which looks very similar to our usual linear equations. Methods for solving this type of matrix equation are beyond the scope of this video. Another easy example is that matrices may be used to represent graphical transforms. If we think of X and Y as an ordered pair, then the matrix times the column XY gives us a new ordered pair, which is the image of the new point following our transformation. The matrix on top is performing a 90-degree rotation, while the one underneath is scaling X and Y by different amounts. We can apply multiple transformations by simply multiplying by the sequence of transformation matrices in the order we wish to perform the transforms. So hopefully this gives you enough information to get started working with matrices. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching.